We're going to have a series of four talks, equatorial, sort of this set is about and around the canyons. The first talk will be by McEwen, Chinaki, Miyamoto, Henry, or I'm not saying it right, Weitz, Williams, Quanten, Fleho, Ray, Turner, and Bridges, and it is entitled Landing Site and Exploration Zone in Eastern Mellis Chasma, and Alfred McEwen will be presenting the talk. The rules for this, and will be for the rest of the talks in all of the sessions, someone will get up and tell you or motion that there's 5 minutes left. They will get up and pace around when there's 3 minutes left, and you'll get shut off at 15. There's two reasons for that. The first is we want to get to dinner before midnight. The second is it's to ensure that everybody gets the same amount of time to present their sites. We don't want to screw somebody one way or the other.
So all questions are during the discussion.
Yeah, so we'll defer questions unless you finish ahead of time. Alfred.
Okay. East Mellis Chasm. Can everyone hear me okay without the headphone there?
They want you to use it for the recording.
Okay. How's it go? Okay, everyone hear me?
Yep.
Okay, so where are we? We're in the lowest spot on the equator of Mars, right in the middle of Valles Marineris. Here's zooming in with MOLA data. The elevation ranges from about -5.3 to -0.7 kilometers. It's a wide opening in the canyon here. That's a 100 kilometer radius circle that you'll see over and over again. So this site meets all of the threshold requirements. It meets all of the landing site and rover constraints. It has easy access to raw materials for ISRU, namely the polyhydrated sulfates that I'll say more about. Other raw materials are readily available, basaltic sand with metal and silicons. Infrastructure can be less than 5 kilometers from the landing site, maybe with a little work. For the science threshold, there's high preservation potential for past habitability in several different sites that I'll describe, and a promising site for present habitability locations with the RSL, recurring slope lineae. There are Noachian and Hesperian datable crustal units with regional extents, aqueous and groundwater processes, and stratigraphic contacts and cross-cutting relations galore in Valles Marineris. It doesn't get any better than that. So one issue that comes up whenever you talk about Valles Marineris are the high winds, and this eliminated the Mellis landing site for MIR. That was with airbags. At the 2020 landing set workshop in August, it was reported that the latest wind model did not pose a problem for the southwest Mellis site. That's a site to the west of this site. But my co-authors, Cecilia Leung and Scott Rafkin, have done some mesoscale modeling. And this region in central Mellis Chasm, or eastern Mellis Chasm, has relatively calm winds. We don't think it's a problem. Yeah, it's right about over here, actually. It's a small closed basin. This is the Themis nighttime IR image and a thermal inertia map down here. So these are generally, the dark areas here are moderate thermal inertia, basically sandy surfaces. The bright areas are more bedrock. There's very little of the dust that's worrisome. There's a couple of slope maps for parts of the area, and the bottom line is that they're less than 10 degrees everywhere except along some obvious scarps and steep slopes, but extensive interconnected areas with low slopes. So for in-situ resource utilization, we're recommending the use of polyhydrated sulfates. There's two things you need to know about polyhydrated sulfates. One, it contains a lot of water, up to 50% by volume, and two, that water is not available to biology. It's not a special region. So those two characteristics are key, as we've heard from the previous discussion. And extracting the water is relatively easy. You have to heat it above 150 degrees C. So this is this was discovered initially by Omega, and this is a map. The blue is the polyhydrated sulfate. The yellow, the green is kieserite monohydrated sulfate. The yellow is a mix of the two. There's lots of this polyhydrated sulfate here in this ellipse. Just for fun, we did an estimation how much water is there in this exploration zone. So the internal layer deposit volume is about 40,000 cubic kilometers. The band depths indicate about 10% sulfates. And depending on whether it's polyhydrated sulfate or kieserite, if you assume it's mostly kieserite, you come up with a total of about 10 to the 12th cubic meters. That's 1,000 cubic kilometers. That's 2 times Lake Erie. So there is, if you believe this estimate, there is more water than in Lake Erie sitting in this exploration zone. But, well, of course, that's much more than what we need. But, of course, the issue is economics. So assuming we can find a spot that's relatively concentrated, say 20% polyhydrated sulfate, so 10% water overall with 80% efficiency, then we need to process 1,200 cubic meters. That's like a 24 by 25 meter area, 2 meters deep. Here's an HRC oblique view that shows these mesas of interior layer deposits, and you can see the bright outcrops of the sulfates nicely in this view. There's a lag deposit covering most of this. And the next view, we're going to look obliquely to the east over this area. So here's this view from HRC. This is 5 times vertical exaggeration, but this shows several key things. A landing site we're proposing is about here. There are sedimentary layers with polyhydrated sulfates near the base of the section. It's usually near the top of the section stratigraphically, but it's located here near the base of the section for some reason. Here's a CTX context. This spot here is, here's this chrism spectrum, and you compare that with magnesium sulfate that contains 7 H2O molecules. It's a pretty good fit. So you land here, and the floor is flat, so you can easily access this site. We can also access the RSL sites that are located here, and on the on 2 craters, a Gardening crater there, another crater right there. So these sites are accessible. Here's a high-rise color image of some of this polyhydrated sulfate. You can see these hollows. I interpret that as wind erosion. Sulfates are expected to be soft and friable. I think that's been confirmed by Opportunity, where the rat didn't wear out drilling this stuff. And this just shows this, the 25 by 25 meter area that you would need to process to get 100 metric tons of water. For a landing site, I just tried to find the flattest and safest looking 5 by 5 kilometer area with some high-rise coverage. And that's here. Here's a sample of high-rise. There are these ripples that Curiosity could easily drive over. And then we know there are polyhydrated sulfates in this bright band right here from chrism, and some more up in this region. There may be more, probably is more in here. We just don't have the coverage yet. So it may be possible to get closer to this landing site, or it may be possible to have a landing site here. I don't know that that's not safe. There's just a little more roughness elements there. So the main priority for future observations is to understand this issue. Where can we get the best polyhydrated sulfates close to the landing site? I filled out this resource ROI rubric, and it's almost all green, except there isn't any ice. It isn't in the northern hemisphere, and I'm still not sure about getting within 5 kilometers of the landing site. And utilitarian terrain features, I'm not sure about. All right, so I just defined 1 resource ROI here around the landing site. And then we defined 14 science ROIs. We could have done more than that, but had to stop somewhere. this is it's a very rich area in terms of geologic targets. And I will go through these one by one. So I don't, yeah, the movie's working. All right, this is sites 1, 3, and 14 are these recurring slope lineae. Now this could be a resource ROI, but it's problematic because these are very steep slopes, angle of repose slopes, and it's either a special region or it's not very interesting for resources because it could be very small amounts of water. So we think it's better just to have this as a science ROI, and then you can approach it cautiously in terms of planetary protection if nobody's life depends on it. These are seasonal flows in Valles Marineris. They occur on the north-facing slope in northern summer and on the south-facing slopes in southern summer. And so it keeps going around the slopes here. ROI2 is some phyllosilicates and layered deposits. We have more work to do to find the best phyllosilicates. It isn't necessarily this area, but it's a pretty high-rise image that gives some context on that. This is very close to the landing site. Four of these ROI sites include Noachian crust. So Valles Marineris is a unique vertical section through the uppermost kilometers of the Martian crust. It's got a great diversity of rock types. The basic mineralogy is low calcium pyroxene and olivine in the lower walls, which is pristine Noachian or pre-Noachian crust. Scott Murchie calls it pre-Noachian because this is the mineralogy of the bedrock around Hellas, which defines the base of the Noachian. And phyllosilicates are commonly present as an alteration product. There's also a late Hesperian lake. There may have been earlier Hesperian lakes that led to the layer deposits, but there's a closed contour, and as the outflow channels were flowing, water must have backed up here, and these authors interpret a range of features as fluvial features. So that includes part of this landing ellipse, landing exploration zone. So ROI4 includes this area, which looks like eroded sediments, perhaps from draining of the lake. There are some features that might be mud volcanoes. If these are igneous volcanoes, then it's another datable surface, so we're happy either way. There are a couple of sites with Hesperian lake terraces and shorelines. There are several sites for the Hesperian interior layer deposit stratigraphy. Here's the high-rise color sample. Here's a high-rise DTM. This is a thick section with very diverse stratigraphy, so it's very similar to Mount Aeolus in Gale Crater. Seven includes some landslide deposits and dunes. And these landslide deposits have some debris flow-like morphologies, so it might be have been water-based. Two and eight cover some folded and faulted sedimentary layers. So the science ROI rubric is here. You probably can't read these very well, but again, we have a lot of green, at least in the summary, from one side or another, except, again, there's no ice. We don't know anything about trace gas sources. Potential for organic matter with surface exposure, I put that with this partial supported. We have the kind of deposits that are promising, and there is active aeolian processes, so you can have recently exposed layers where the radiation hasn't destroyed the organics. Other than that, I think Gale Crater is the only place where a solid green circle is possible for that category. Okay. High-rise and chrism coverage is just a few percent of the exploration zone, so prioritize data needs. Chrism to find the best polyhydrated sulfates. High-rise stereo to find the best landing sites. These can be coordinated together. Then third priority, chrism to search for additional hydrated minerals. And four, high-rise and high-rise stereo for stratigraphic and other science studies in the science ROIs. We also want to continue high-rise and chrism monitoring the RSL, but I'm assuming that will be done outside the landing site process. T TGO with Cassis can get 4.6 meter per pixel stereo color. I hope we can cover the entire exploration zone. And then a future rover would be great to locate the best polyhydrated sulfates in a small area and understand its physical and chemical properties prior to attempting autonomous ISRU. Jack's proposed mission, Melos, is interested in this specific region. So conclusions, East Melos has it all. It's got water for ISRU without planetary protection problems, low latitudes and elevations, safe landing site, diverse science targets. We get both modern and ancient habitability. So we need to develop engineering systems for ISRU. There are terrestrial polyhydrated sulfates that can be used to develop that. More research to understand RSL. And finally, I want to remind everyone that you can enter high-rise image suggestions at this website, HiWISH. You don't have to wait for the landing site process. We're coming up on high data rate in the next year, so there's a good chance we'll get your data done.
So we're going to hold questions until the discussion.
Thank you, sir. And I'll just talk into this if I can until our next speaker comes up, which I haven't put my glasses on to read the title. So I'm getting old. Is this a BYO picky thing? Or
that works, actually. So the next talk is by Mahara, Rovkin, Zuber, and Carr, and it is entitled Human Exploration of Mars at Valles Marineris, the Past, Present, and Future of Life on Mars, and Christopher Carr will be giving the talk. Angel Mahara will be
Angel
giving the talk. Why is Christopher Carr?
He's the corresponding author.
Okay, but he's listed as giving the talk, so that's an error in the program. Okay. Sorry.
Let's see. Hello, testing 1, 2. Does that work? Yes, no? Is that working? Yes, okay. Sorry, Chris, I'm the one giving the talk here today. So my name is Angel Mahara. I am a geologist by background. I am also a research assistant at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where I am supporting the development of an in-situ life detection instrument. It's called SETG, the Search for Extraterrestrial Genomes. And our goal is to find the site on Mars that could potentially have extant life, sample the soil, extract DNA, and sequence it. With that in mind, we considered many sites on Mars that could potentially have a strong importance for the astrobiology. And some of these talks will be mentioned during this workshop. But ultimately, we went with the site in Valles Marineris, right next to Melos Casba, which Dr. McEwen just talked about. And I'll try to convince you why our site might be better. But it's in Valles Marineris, which is a really cool site on Mars. It has an extensive record of geology. It's about the canyon walls are about 8 kilometers high. So it ranges from early Noachian to Amazonian throughout the whole stratigraphy. And there's also, it's an equatorial site, so it's easily accessible. It has a high atmospheric pressure, which is one of the highest atmospheric pressures on the entire planet, which is really important for an in-situ oxygen generator such as MOXIE, if you want to create oxygen on Mars. It has high solar year-round insulation, which is really important for our astronauts if you want to keep them warm, better than the high latitude sections. And these two really cool features on Mars, the one on the left, it's water ice fogs that's been verified by the Mars Express satellite. It's the only place on Mars that has this morning ice fog cycles. It could potentially be harvested for water directly from the atmosphere instead of going to these RSL sites or looking for regolith ice mixes. The one on the right, it's these RSLs, which have been confirmed to be of atmospheric origin, these water seepages here. And there's a high density of these things in Mars, so besides the fog and besides the RSLs, there's potential for a lot of water resources there as well. And overall, Valles Marineris is a really cool site to visit, brought to you by the Mars Colonization and Tourism Board here. Here's a map of our exploration zone, number 1036. Here's our coordinates. Our altitude is minus 4.8 kilometers below sea level. Here we have our habitable zone and our landing zone clearly labeled. The thing in blue is our science region of interest number 1, which is up in the valley walls. It's mostly RSLs and Amazonian through knocking stratigraphy. Our third site are these cross-cutting alluvial fans, which gives us relative ages. We think that they might be of aqueous origin. Our fourth site are these twin impact craters at the edge of the alluvial fans, potential sites for RSLs as well, or maybe impact glasses that could preserve biosignatures. Our fifth site are these Noachian blocks, which could potentially be tilted due to the rifting of the formation of Valles Marineris. So it's a potential site to access this high stratigraphy from the valley walls horizontally, kind of walk along it. And then we have this larger impact crater in the south eastern side of our region, which has a lot of confirmed and accessible RSLs. And our two resource regions of interest are further down on the canyon or valley walls, which is mostly the mass wasted material of pristine Noachian and Hesperian material, a lot of olivine or basalt, magnesium, iron smectite, stuff like that. Our exploration zone meets a lot of the science regions of interest rubrics. It's very heavy on the astrobiology, potential for past and present habitability at these RSL sites. It's also very heavy on the geology. There's a lot of range of stratigraphy there, Noachian, Hesperian, Amazonian, which could be dated. And there's evidence for past aqueous activity, and you could potentially interpret relative ages based on the cross-cutting of in some of these features. For the resources, we're very heavy on the water, potentially from RSLs, from the atmosphere, or from subsurface ice regolith mixes. Our landing site meets all the requirements for the civil engineering, and a lot of the mass wasted material could be potentially used as feedstock for our food production or metal silicon resources. Here is our first science region of interest, number 1 and 2. It's on the top left, you'll be seeing these context images with our exploration zone and the color-coded regions of interest. This one here is a CTX image from the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. You see it's from this little square here. And as I mentioned earlier, Valles Marineris is a great site to have a comprehensive, if not the best, Noachian through Hesperian stratigraphy with the Amazonian cap. It might be a little difficult to access. I don't know if astronauts would want to climb up these things. It's up to them. It won't be fun if you don't go. As long as they're game. Yeah. There's also a high density of RSLs, which could potentially increase the probability of life on Mars. Or if there's any life, this is a pretty good site to sample. So as I said, a great site search for Mars. But you may ask, if some astronauts aren't game, or if it might be a little too dangerous, you can also send these helicopters or robots, which would be really cool, to sample RSLs for potential extant life, or to sample some of the stratigraphy as well. That's really cool. Our third science region of interest are these two alluvial fans. It's Copperies labies and Ophir labies. I forget which one's which. But they have a cross-cutting relationship here. The top one is older than the bottom one. And if they are of aqueous origin, it could have potentially brought subsurface life from a subsurface aquifer onto the basin wall, onto the basin valley and preserve it. So there's a lot of potential for ice regolith mix as well if it is of aqueous origin, potential for preserved subsurface life. And there's also a diverse lithology from the mass wasted materials that could have fallen down. So another site to easily access Noachian or Hesperian to Amazonian units that were up on the valley wall that came down. Our fourth site are these twin impact craters. They're kind of hard to see in the context image here. They're kind of small. The one on the left is a CTX. The one on the right is a high-rise image. And these two are very similar to Garney Crater, the site that Dr. McEwen just talked about, similar diameter. So we could potentially look for RSLs here as well for water resource or potential habitat for life on Mars today. We will need further high-rise imagery to verify that. And if you see kind of close, the contrast isn't high enough here. There's exposed stratigraphy as well, which could tell us about the Noachian to pre-Noachian sediments during the rifting of Valles Marineris. And also, a recent paper came out by Mustard and Cannon. Is Jack Mustard here? I didn't see him. That impact glasses could preserve biosignatures. So if there was some kind of organics transported from these alluvial fans, it could have been artificially preserved in impact glasses away from the harsh surface environment on Mars. Our fifth site are these fault blocks. You can see them here. It's a little nice, an echelon. And we hope that they're tilted. They might not be tilted. They might just be mesas. But if they are tilted, it's a great way to look for or to study walking through Hesperian stratigraphy, just walking along the line instead of having to climb up this 8 kilometer high wall. Here's a little example from an old geology textbook from 1893. We had proposed our landing site to be, our habitable zone to be on top of the westernmost block. It's a little ambition for the first mission, but we could start the landing, the habitable zone in this little area here, protected from the winds, protected from migrating sand dunes, and then ultimately end up on top of the fault block to have a nice 360 view of the entire valley. It'd be very psychologically pleasing for our astronauts to have a good view of everything. And our landing zone is just south of this region, which meets all the criteria. It's low thermal inertia and pretty flat terrain to land. Our sixth site is this larger impact crater on the southeastern portion of our exploration zone. And it has confirmed and accessible RSLs from a paper from McHugh in 2014. So it's a great site to look for extant life. Again, I'm part of this in situ life detection instrument, so we're very biased towards a zone that could potentially have life. So we want to sample that, sequence it, and see if it's related to life on Mars or if there's even life there. I mean, life on Earth, and see if it's even there. Here in the center, we have this large rebound basin, which could potentially have impact glasses. So again, if there was any kind of subsurface life, it could have artificially been preserved in this impact glass. And there's a lot of exposed basin stratigraphy, which could tell us about the rifting event of Las Marineras. And our two resource regions of interest, it's mostly the mass wasted material from the canyon or valley walls. It's a lot of basalt, a lot of olivine, a lot of clay materials, iron magnesium from the iron magnesium smectites, some silicon. So you can use it for any kind of in situ feedstock, or if you want to take 3D printing to Mars, you can do that. So our highest priority data needs for our exploration zone, we want high-rise imagery for these twin impact craters, to see whether or not there is RSO activity there. There's also a similar impact crater here and here, which could also host RSLs. They weren't included in our science regions of interest. We would want high rise up on the valley walls. It's kind of ambitious, but if we find a good site, we can settle for that. And then we would also want to confirm the stratigraphy of these fault blocks, whether or not they're tilted or if they're mesas that were fluvial origin. Here's an example of high-res imagery. This is the Ares 3 landing site for the Martian. And then we also want some CRISM data to verify the composition of these alluvial fans. There's already data on some of these sites, but we would have to do more extensive analysis to confirm whether or not we could use it for in situ resource usages, or if there's enough water ice to be used. Same thing for these lower portions of the valley walls here. And we would also want to assess the ice content of the landing site, if there's enough water there to exploit for our astronauts. And for this larger impact crater, whether or not it could have been a paleo lake at some point, sustained life. Here's an example of a CRISM image with identified lithologies like olivine basalt. Yeah, thank you.
Sorry, program have not you as the speaker, but I'm glad you were here.
That's right. Hey, Chris.
Is he here?
No, he's online.
Thank you, Andrew. Okay. Okay, hopefully you have your little rubrics and scorecards. I guess they're not really scorecards. I shouldn't call it that.
So I heard Lindsay reprimand me from afar.
Okay, the third talk in this session, we're going to move a little bit outside of Valles Marineris now. It's by Carr Farrell, and it's Mars Landing Plus 50 Years, Repurposing the First Viking Landing Site in Crissy Planitia as an Exploration Zone for automated infrastructure construction.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Yeah, just want to check if this is on. Okay, great. Well, it's a pleasure introducing for the second time the Viking landing site. What you see on this particular image in the front, that's sort of what you get. You get the boulders, drifts, a variety of cobbles and sand. It's a relatively flat area, which has been interpreted by some, I guess, as boring, but perhaps that's of interest here. So want to talk a little bit about the context of where we are here. We're looking at roughly the center of a location in which the affluent of a variety of valleys may have emanated, Maja Vallis and Kasi Vallis. We're looking here at also a geologic context map from Larry Crumpler from the 2001 era. Basically, we're looking at a variety of erosion and deposition areas in this site, and that's what we would be exploring beyond the location of the Viking 1 lander. The exploration zone map we see here at the 50-kilometer radius, we're looking at a resource area towards the center of the zone, and scientific areas emanating from that, basically to the southwest, north and south, and a large impact crater, the Yorktown. There's a number of other locales which we could be exploring outside of this 50-kilometer area, which would roughly be similar to what we would experience inside this radius. What we're looking for here, this is also from Crumpler 2001 that I've highlighted in the center, is really an examination of whether or not this is an area from either erosion or deposition. If we see the Viking 1 lander here using this particular cross-section, we see a potential geotraverse from highlands to lowlands, a potential high stand level with deposition areas near the lander and erosional areas to the highlands to the north. To the south and to the west. And what we're looking here is whether or not there would be areas of deposition and a former standing body of water that would have been indicated outflow events, which still would have locations where we would find water ice. So we're looking here at several science ROIs. The first is the study of the Viking 1 landing site and its vicinity. This would be a unique location for the exploration of Mars. The geotraverses, the erosional landforms, and also Xanthatora dorsa wrinkle ridges, and the central peak and ramparts of a pristine crater on this area. The first is the SROI-1, which is the Thomas Much Memorial VL-1 site here. We can see in this high-rise site, we can see the lander noted here, the back shell and the parachute, the subdued surface area, which is a roughly flat surface, approximately 1.7 to 2 kilometers below the mean local elevation. And what we would find here in this site would be the various trenches that were made by the lander, various potential outcrops of bedrock, rocks with vesicles that may indicate trapped atmospheric gases, and these drift deposits, which may be remnants of the deposit areas. So what we have is the potential retrieval and the study of the lander hardware from Viking 1, roughly 50 or so years after it was placed there on Mars. Previously, we've spoken other speakers have mentioned the degree of efficiency in which the Viking lander was cleaned of microbes and so forth. We can look at other aspects of that lander to see what has occurred in terms of erosion and changes to the morphology since its emplacement. We're looking at a rich assemblage of petrologic materials, including rocks with vesicles, as well as those of a smoother quality, which may indicate different origins of basalt and other samples. We're looking at re-examination of the astrobiologic findings of Viking 1. One might notice that the presence of ice or organics still is potentially a controversial subject here, but it may be worthwhile examining this location a second time for those particular properties. From the potential of exposure of basaltic soils, we see here from Guinness et al. 1980, the examination of the so-called control drift, in which after a particular dust storm revealed scouring and revealed darker soils, which may be indicative of examination of darker basaltic locations. Looking at the science ROIs 2 and 3, it's indicated a geotraverse to the southwest, basically looking for the western margin of the Crissy Basin, potentially a depositional plain. This would be an outflow to the late Hesperian channel systems in this catchment area. And the travel upstream towards the Masha Fan to reveal history of these flooding events. We haven't, instead of just a single point in terms of zone of interest, we might find statistical variations in the numbers and the types of cobbles, boulders, and sediments that would exist along that path, which would be clues to the parental units, changes of the history of the origin of that deposit, and a possible evidence for astrobiological origin of some of these items which had been placed into this lower elevation Crissy Basin. Looking at items SRI 4 and 5, we would be transiting in a north-south area, the Xanthidorsa wrinkle ridges, to examine the ridged plains and to look at the early Hesperian compression events that did precede the aqueous events of the Hesperian. So this would be the transit along a particular dorsa for evidence of geochemical gradients, sampling along that, and looking for evidence of early Hesperian volcanism and changes along that path. The examination of these modified crater rims, possibly of earlier Hesperian ages, would also be taken into account on this more of a geotraverse area. Investigation of landforms from aqueous processes. One knows that there is also a potential possibility for looking at the transition from erosion to deposition of the deposits along this transit. Looking at a pristine crater, Yorktown, one might find the examination of Hesperian basalts, which would have an olivine and clinopyroxene component to them. If we look at the potential covering layer or a blanketing area layer on top of these, they would be exposed in the crater walls and potentially the ejecta blankets. The ejecta blankets themselves may have indications of aqueous processes which form the ramparts, possible RSL formation in the rims, and the sampling of those rims and ejecta blankets might be intriguing for examination of aqueous processes. But this particular site moves beyond that of science to looking at the resources involved with them. We look at the resources involved with the volcanic bedrock and stratified drift deposits, large numbers of cobbles, regolith, and basalt for ease of construction. This salt, basalt in the based silica feedstocks, and potential for readily available ice deposits. If we transit to the north of the main resource location, we would find potential evidence of to the north would be another confluence of several channel systems. Case Vales to the northwest, we may have had more than one episode of erosion, and this would possibly indicate floodwaters coursing through these channel systems, which may be different from the floodwaters to the southwest. Again, another potential for ice deposits. The rubrics here, again, water potential water ice, safe descent, relief of less than 100 meters for construction of large sites, the stability of the of the bedrock for touchdown of human landers, and accessible rocks and drifts for this site. Filling out the rubric, there are the astrobiologic indications are not complete here, owing to the original Viking results. They are still very much in question, but we do have qualifying and threshold criteria met for the geosciences and the aqueous processes for this particular location. But in looking more at the resource rubric, we find that a fair amount of the resources that would be required for this location, this would be met by the Crissy Planitia resource. The issues become that of the presence and the compositions of organic matter and the presence and depth of water ice deposits. These would be potentially fulfilled by the types of advanced orbiter spacecraft that we heard a talk about earlier today. Thank you so much.
Okay, the final talk, no stranger to the Lunar and Planetary Institute, Clifford, Kring, and Treeman, the Eastern Outlet of Valles Marineris, a window into the ancient geologic and hydrologic evolution of Mars, and Steve Clifford will be giving the talk.
Thank you, John.
Got it. I think.
No, other one. Goes.
Bad news, but I can't even put on the microphone.
Yeah,
all right, well, this Valles Marineris turns out to be a popular topic for this afternoon's session. The previous landing sites were proposed in the central part of Valles Marineris. The landing site I'm proposing, however, is at the very eastern end of Valles Marineris. These landing sites may very well be the best landing sites to go to for a number of reasons. My concern is basically hydrologic, and that is the amount of water that was involved in this part of the canyon system is only a small amount of the total inventory of water that exited from Valles Marineris and entered the northern plains. Much of the additional water came from these chaos regions at the eastern end of Valles Marineris. There's a topographic depression about 10,000 square kilometers in size in this region that would have acted as a place for water to pool unless the amount was large enough to actually push it over topographic rise in the eastern outlet here and push it into the northern plains. Okay, this is just a cartoon showing the kinds of flows that could have contributed to the flow out of this eastern outlet of Valles Marineris. This is a geologic map by Whitbeck et al. It actually shows a little bit more detail than the recent global map by Tanaka et al. We've got Tuskegee Crater. It's a 60-kilometer crater on the north wall, and the wall goes very, very close to it, which gives you a cross-section of not only the Noachian crust, but also what the effects of a very large impact may have been on the Noachian crust with regard to both brecciation, magmatism in association with the impact, and potential hydrothermal activity. There are also three large landslides that come off the north wall, and a smaller landslide that's in this region that comes off the, well, I guess you'd call it the eastern or southeastern wall. There's a streamline island. There's a lot of chaotic terrain, and there are a few other elements that I'll talk about a little bit further on in the talk. The landing site location is at essentially 4 degrees south, 325 degrees east. These are the surface properties at the landing site as calculated using the Mars 2020 tool on JMARS. These are the science ROIs, and there is a very general resource ROI that I'll talk about at the very end of the talk. But the science ROIs consist of a ponded feature located right next to chaotic terrain at the inlet of this channel. There are channel floor deposits, which are obviously available everywhere within the exploration zone, so we're not unique to a particular location, so they can be sampled right at the doorstep of the base. Number three is channel floor craters, using them as probes into the stratigraphy of the channel floor. Again, any fluvial discharge from Valles Marineris would have had to exit to the northern plains through this 50 to 75 kilometer wide channel. So there's very likely a sedimentary record of those discharges that's been preserved in the channel sediments. I'm trying to find my four. Okay, streamlined island. This island could either be a remnant of the Noachian basement, or it could also be sediments that were transported by a very early massive discharge through the canyon system, and then were later eroded by a still larger discharge. But it seems to be a very readily accessible location from the proposed landing site. Number five is chaotic terrain. Again, this is in close proximity to the ponded feature, the ponded deposit, that is the number one ROI for this particular site. There is the plateau valley wall, looking at the stratigraphy and structure. Again, over on this wall, we see approximately 3 to 3.5 kilometers of exposed Noachian stratigraphy. The top of the plateau is Noachian. There are some valley networks in places around here. So what we're seeing is an accumulation, stratigraphic record that's several kilometers of material earlier the fall and the decline in the valley networks 4 billion years ago. Finally, we've got the opportunity to actually sample the rock wall by going to these landslides with a rover or crewed vehicle and acquiring spectroscopically identical rocks from the landslide as can be compared with the stratigraphy in the canyon walls. Okay, the rubric, I used a lot of the solid green dots and the question marks and blanks. I never found anything that I could use the partial support or debate it. Most of the issues in the science regard whether or not there is recently exposed organic material or the potential for recently exposed organic material. And also, as Alfred mentioned earlier, the likelihood of ice at these latitudes at least within a few tens of meters of the subsurface appears unlikely, but an investigation like the synthetic aperture radar that's been proposed for 2022 might go a long way to testing that belief. This is the resource rubric, and there are a lot of question marks here, and that may reflect as much my ignorance of the CRISM data as it does anything else. Looking at some of the specific features, the number one feature that I've identified for this site is, again, this ponded deposit in close proximity to the chaotic terrain. This is a topographic depression and could very well have captured sediments and may have even hosted a local body of water during the decline of the outflow phase of Valles Marineris. Second science ROI were, again, the channel deposits. The third is the use of craters on the channel floor to assess the stratigraphy of the channel within this larger crater here, about 4 kilometers in diameter. I think about 20 or so kilometers from, 20 to 30 kilometers away from the base. The center of the crater goes down about 700 meters below the surrounding channel floor. We've got a slightly smaller crater up on the north and a sub-kilometer crater to the south of the landing site. Using a combination of GPR and shallow drilling, something of the nature of the ExoMars investigation, but perhaps tuned for lower frequency, would allow you to get a good understanding of the local geologic context here. The Stream Island I spoke of before, the elevation at the channel floor is about 3,600 meters, minus 3,600 meters. The maximum elevation on the island is minus 3,065 meters. So a good stack of layers to investigate in the central part of the canyon. Whoops. Again, the chaotic terrain. This is just a small portion of a very extensive region, again, covering tens of thousands of square kilometers of chaotic terrain at the east end of the channel. The Tuskegee Crater, there is approximately 3 to 3.5 kilometers worth of Noachian stratigraphy observable here. The location of the avalanches from which we might be able to get samples of the wall rock are just a few tens of kilometers from
essentially the closest slice of the canyon wall to Tuskegee. And again, you could do a number of important scientific studies looking at what the effect of large impacts was on the brecciation and igneous modification and hydrothermal activity associated with large impacts during this time. And this is just a close-up showing the landslides to the north of Tuskegee. Again, I had one resource region of interest, and we see that there are some sheet silicates, very little carbonate and sulfate, and lots of basalt that are located in this area. It didn't seem as if there was a dense coverage of prism data in this particular region. So one of the things, actually I'm going to skip to this slide, data that would be useful to assess the viability of this landing site would be a full high-rise coverage of the area, looking for things like RSLs, geologic evidence of past, present climate, water, ice, and habitability. CRISM full coverage, and also high-resolution synthetic aperture radar, full spatial coverage at multiple times per day. And this is because of an issue that actually Alfred and I discussed at EPSC, which is that RSLs may not be the only indication of the potential presence of a brine. Brines might very well exist in flat areas, but we don't see any manifestation of it in the high-resolution imagery simply because the brines aren't flowing. Something like a synthetic aperture radar at the right frequency chosen to sound the upper few meters of the subsurface could provide a very good test of that. Another supplement would be the sending an ExoMars or Mars 2020 class rover to investigate the actual landing site before you commit any resources there. That's my talk.
Thank you. Oh, oh. There it is. So now we move into a discussion phase.
Yeah, Josh, do you have the rubric, the merge, or? So actually, while he's up there, this is the man who, if you haven't given your talks to for the first session in the morning, it would be good if you do, if they're actually done. if not, find him in the morning. Otherwise, for tomorrow, if you are talking tomorrow, please hand them to him. You know, no later than, you need to find him during the break before your talk to make sure they're uploaded, because that will save a bunch of time.
So I had a question to start things off while he's getting the rubric up. Angel, you talked about the fogs in Valles Marineris. I can't see where you are. There you are. There's a very bright light behind you. Alfred, do those extend into that? It looks like they extend into the area immediately to the west that is covered by Alfred's RO. Yeah, so they're there as well.
I would say they're controversial. That you see this relatively blue-colored material in Viking and HRSC, but Omega has studied that, has not seen any water ice evidence for that. The PFS on Mars Express, there is one spectrum that seems to show some evidence of water ice, and it could, in theory, see deeper below some dust. But it's only that one spectrum. That's the only evidence for water ice there. I think that the color is not evidence for water ice. That's just a scattering property.
It's the Molman paper.
Yeah, it's the Molman paper, and they show that one spectrum. But I think that's an unknown issue at this point. Is that really water ice fog? It doesn't make sense in terms of the temperatures. It's warm down there. There shouldn't be forming fog.
And I guess going the other way, let me just go quickly through and then I'll to seed this a little bit. The polyhydrated sulfates, Alfred, that you were mapping do or do not extend into the region that Angel was looking at? Angel? Do the polyhydrated sulfates that Alfred was talking about, do those extend into the area that you're looking at? Yeah, I thought so based on Alfred's map, but he didn't show them.
I don't remember it. It might.
I think it might, yeah. I didn't think too much.
And I guess for Carr, a quick question was, you talked about the crater up near Crissy and talked about putative RSLs. And are those part of Alfred's possible RSLs, or are you saying that they're possible RSLs?
Possible, yeah.
So,
yeah.
Sorry, Alfred.
Yeah.
We haven't seen anything there, although up in, and David, he's just published a paper, paper online about that area.
550 kilometers.
Okay. That doesn't mean in the future we won't see something there.
We have one image that's there, and then they should be there, and they're not. But maybe they're a different season there. Right.
And I guess for Steve and for Carr, a big question for you guys is with CRISM data, looking at the resource questions, and perhaps in your case in particular, wanting the new instrument platforms that would be able to possibly tease out that kind of information related to ground ice. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah.
Okay, so with that, let's just open it up now.
Yeah, I mean, particularly we want comments.
In the back, he's very eager.
Eager guy at the back.
Sure. This is mostly a question for Alfred, but for anyone else, can you comment a little bit on the utility of RSLs from a ISRU point of view versus a object of scientific interest?
If you might.
Yeah, I didn't want to. I started off thinking ISRU with RSL, after realizing these polyhydrated sulfates eliminate so many of the problems, I thought that was a much better choice. They're on steep slopes, angle of repose slopes. We really haven't seen them at all on slopes flatter than angle of repose, so very difficult to work. And if it's significant water, then it's also a planetary protection issue, so that's a major issue. So that combination makes it seem very problematic to me. But it's a great topic for future research to learn more about them.
It could be really little water that makes it.
Yeah.
Really salty.
Right. Yeah, maybe very little water. It may be very salty, but these are things we don't know.
See, I get megatons out of RSL.
Yeah. So the work we've been doing. Yeah.
So, go ahead.
Matt. The work we've been doing shows that you can definitely get megatons or metric tons of water out of the RSL. Yeah.
Megatons is how you get it out.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's a question right behind you.
Can I ask? Actually, I wanted to ask about volcanics and datable surfaces in this region. Because I think the only mention I heard of volcanics was Alfred talking about the ancient Noachian crust that's exposed in the walls. I think that's the only time that was mentioned in this session?
No, Carr talked about the Dorsa in Crissy.
Right, but in Valles Marineris.
Hesperian age volcanics.
Right, but in Valles Marineris, that's the only exposure of volcanics. So is it true that there are no datable volcanic surfaces in Valles Marineris at these sites?
Well, I think that Noachian bedrock is datable. It's igneous, right? I
mean, is it cratered? Does it have an exposed cratered surface?
It's datable from radiometric dating, not from impact crater.
Right.
I thought we were talking about radiometric dating.
Well,
real
I thought
dating,
the point was. Well, okay. So thinking back to 2020 and that same requirement for 2020, the point was to be able to connect the cratering timescale to radiometric dates.
So the Hesperian flood lavas on top would be excellent for that, and maybe the landslides bring some of that down, but you don't know for sure where its context. So that's not ideal.
Other questions?
Yeah. In spite of their proximity and presumed environmental similarities, there seems to be a real disparity between the Melas and Copratis sites when it comes to the interpretation of potential for ice, ground ice. The presenters like to comment on that?
Well, the models do not predict that ice will be stable near the surface in the equatorial region of Mars, and there's no evidence for ice. So I'm assuming it's probably not there.
What McEwen said. But there is CRISM data that supports some water ice in the alluvial fans and as well as our the larger impact crater. So more study would be, it would be worth studying that some more.
See, I have a comment on your alluvial fan. I think those are landslide deposits.
I think they're aqueous origin.
but I'm curious, even if they're alluvial fans, they're not notoriously famous for preserving organics. So I'm wondering if that's a high priority, why would you, what's special about those that might allow that to occur?
So if it was from a subsurface aquifer burst of Amazonian age, potentially, and if there is subsurface life on Mars, I could potentially transport that life to the basin. And if they are recent and below the surface, they could have potentially been preserved from the harsh radiation environment on the surface. DNA can last a couple, I think the modeling says DNA can last about a million years, but if there was that impact crater within a timely manner, it could have, I'm spinning a yarn here, but if an impact crater comes in and then preserves the DNA, then there's potential for preserved organics as well.
Okay. It's
we got
hard.
One at the back was
first. Yeah, she's been waiting.
Well, I have one thing to say to you, which is that you're not even sure DNA is there, that it's DNA. So maybe if it's DNA based, but that's like totally debatable for astrobiology purposes. And then my question is, I just wanted to clarify for the first group, the Melis Chasma. You said that the polyhydrated sulfates made it not a planetary protection issue. Can you elaborate on that?
Right, so there's water that's trapped in the crystal structure. It's not available to biology.
Okay, thank you.
It's H2O trapped in the structure, probably a better way to say it.
No, it's H2O. I was just wanted to talk about RSLs as a potential for extant life environment. I think my personal opinion is it does not the best place to go looking for extant life, but maybe our best one so far, but I don't know. I wanted to hear what people's thoughts were.
I have no idea. If there's there's evidence for current activity, there's evidence for water being present. It isn't necessarily, the recent NASA press release talked about flowing water. I would say it's something is moving down the slope and there's water involved. It isn't necessarily viscous or Newtonian flow of water. It could be water activity that triggers more of a dry mass wasting process. But if it is more of a, if it is seepage of water and it isn't too salty, then it seems that's basically all we know, and that's a better potential for life than other places we know of on Mars. That's all I care to say. Maybe someone else would like to make a stronger pitch.
Well, and Carol behind you also wanted to say something. Microphone somewhere.
From the modeling we're doing, it's probably not too briny. I do think there's actually liquid water flowing down, but yeah, and it's not too briny. It's above probably 252 in most places, 252K. So, it's a possibility.
Did Carol want to add something?
So the recent paper that prompted the headquarters press release focused on the RSL's production method of being deliquescence. If that is the case, then they probably can't be biologically active because they would be too high in salt.
So that
if there's other mechanism for producing them, then it's the
that,
situation might be better.
That was not the focus of that paper. The paper was the detection of hydrated perchlorates and whether it's deliquescence or not. I think there's deliquescence is a strong candidate myself, but that just wasn't the conclusion of this paper. It probably supports that.
Yeah, taking the Antarctic perspective, Carol, there are deliquescent salts in water tracts in Antarctica that, you know, line the fringes, and then the water activity increases towards the center and at depth. So you would see saturated brines at the surface, but there's actually a microbially inhabited biosphere in the interiors and at depth, you know, just a few centimeters. So just seeing saturated brines doesn't necessarily tell you what the water activity is doing within the RSL.
Good point.
All
I would like to ask about the Viking site. It looked like the images were the original images, and I am ignorant of what new information we have. Is there any CRISM stuff, high-rise stuff?
There are some, yes. There are some for the overall hall area.
And the one, the high-rise that I showed was of the actual site itself, which shows the lander on the surface. Do we have any other answers to that, if whether or not there's some chemical?
There must have been coordinated CRISM CTX high-rise taken of the Viking 1 lander.
Right. I'm not aware of hydrated minerals being detected
neither
there.
Neither am I, but I'm sure the data is there.
High-rise.
Yeah.
High-rise is it?
Matt said the salt and dust.
Coordinated.
Yeah, my impression.
That was a con- Go ahead, Dave.
I was going to ask Steve Clifford if he could comment more on the potential for preservation of ancient biosignatures. That site seemed like it was more of a flow site than a deposition site. Steve, any thoughts?
Well, the flow obviously occurred through this site. But I think the significant thing is that it's part of a topographic basin. As you go from Valles Marineris out to the northern plains, there's actually a peak in the channel topography. So everything to the west of that peak would be a sink for any water that was discharged by Valles Marineris, whether from the chaotic terrain, from canyon lakes, or what have you. And sink isn't actually the right word. It would have been a topographic depression that would have filled with water before any water dumped into the northern plains, and it would have taken a while for that water to disappear, even after active flow to the northern plains was over. During that time, if the water was fed by a sub-permafrost aquifer, if that was the source of the original discharge, or if it was some long-lived lakes that existed in the mid portion of the canyon system, you could easily envision the kind of processes that would occur in a lacustrine environment on the Earth in terms of the potential preservation of organic material.
There may be a question for Steve and all the other presenters. Are there important access at depth requirements for these sites? Are there interesting things that you couldn't just walk up to at this site?
I personally think it would be nuts not to have a GPR on a mission like this. In fact, I think from now on, in terms of rover investigations, one way in which you connect the stratigraphy that you see in one crater to the stratigraphy you see in another crater is to be able to follow its continuity with a GPR. So I think that this is a really important technique that can add considerably to our understanding of what the subsurface stratigraphy of a site is and what the geologic history of a site is. I think that, supplemented with perhaps shallow drilling between crater investigations, would be an excellent way to ground truth some of the geophysical studies.
For Malis, I would say we see lots of interesting stuff right at the surface, so that's a good start.
Other questions? Yeah.
At my first glance, Malis and Capraris both look like really compelling exploration zones with lots of diverse science. My only worry is that it is in the middle of a giant canyon. So would there be any wind speed issues that could cause danger during landing or not?
Yeah, I showed you specifically the mesoscale modeling done for Eastern Malis Chasm and the slope winds there, and that was an average over times a day. Were not bad there, and it wasn't judged to be bad for the West Malis Basin for 2020. I'm not sure about Capraris, that's probably a bit worse because it's closer to the steep canyon walls, which produce high slope winds. It depends on the design of this system, too, though. I don't know if any of those winds are a problem, necessarily.
Well, they don't know yet. I mean, I can look at what they say, but they're
civic control. The thing they're most concerned about is being able to land out
I think she's tailing off.
Yeah, this is a question for all the presenters. Have you looked at metal deposits as another resource? That's a secondary resource. Hematite comes to mind.
Yeah, I assume with lots of basaltic sand, you get silicon and iron and magnesium, the major things that were listed. That's not necessarily, I don't know how economical it is to process basalt for those materials.
I think, Carr, you called that out as a major resource potential for your area.
With basaltic sands, same processes.
I don't think we have the remote sensing data to say whether there's, if there are places with concentrated metal, except maybe the hematite deposits that we see in places.
Yeah, this is just a follow-up to Steve Clifford's comment about GPR. For those of you who don't know, a GPR was put on the Lunar Exploration Rover during our mission simulations and worked in real time for characterizing the stratigraphy that crew drove over.
And it worked well. I'm not allowed to say that.
This is just a quick follow-up on the question about the potential for the metals. Talking about the polyhydrated sulfates, and I guess this is a question for you because you brought it up, but for everyone over the next few days, if we start talking about processing materials like that to extract the water, is there some consideration from the proposers or from the ISRU community about the remaining material? Is that hazardous? Do we need to contain it? Do we need to move it away? Is it potentially beneficial? Are there things to be extracted from that once the water has been removed?
Yeah, I think what we're dealing with mainly, besides the sulfates, is basaltic sand. So that's a potential resource for building and for metals and so forth. Is there something else there that's hazardous? Well, I don't know. We need more data.
It's probably not just composition. It's also grain size.
Actually, I thought one of the interesting things about the polyhydrated down here in the front, to the right, the polyhydrated minerals. Following up on that is, I think you, in your slide, you said you heat it to 150 C and you drive off the water. First of all, that's a really low temperature, which is great. And the other is that solves the planetary protection problem. You know, for the most part, you're going to kill anything.
Right, so it's not a planetary protection problem to begin with, locked up in a solid. When you heat it up, then it's fine. Then right. You have to store the water, but that's going to be a problem no matter what if you want water, and it's contained. It's not the whole environment.
Yeah, and regarding what's left over, it's just iron sulfate that's dehydrated. So you're not creating anything new necessarily.
That's what's left over from the polyhydrated sulfate.
That's right, or magnesium sulfate, yeah.
I just wanted to mention that for pulling the iron out of basalt or hematite, it's a really energy-intensive process, so it's questionable whether that would be really worth it, other than just repurposing the basalt and the sand to be used instead of the metals.
Carol?
So you had a slide that showed the presence of the polyhydrated sulfates at what looked like on a slope above the landing site. I'm wondering, is there any data conclusive about what the concentration of those might be?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's really hard to get quantitative concentrations from near IR spectroscopy. Kathy Quantine said that based on the band depth, she thinks it's around 10%, but she wasn't willing to stake her life on that. It might. You know, there may be ways to study the data and try to quantify that better. I'm not sure. It's a difficult problem.
What's the detection limit, though? It's something like around 5 or 6%, isn't it, or something? Sorry, lower.
Yeah, these have pretty strong bands, okay. And they're omega. They're detecting it over very broad areas where it's mostly covered by slag deposits, so they must be detecting pretty low amounts.
We've probably got time for two more. We've got
I just wanted to make a comment with regard to the polyhydrated sulfates and them as a resource ROI. I just want to make sure that we remember that we have to consider the geological context of where these sulfates are, because those are some of your high potential zones where you could have preserved biomarkers. So we don't want to be sourcing these things as resources and destroying our biomarkers as well. So we just want to make sure we recognize the context of where our sulfates are.
Yeah, we should look at the material before we cook it, huh?
So I have just a general question or comment about all these canyon sites. These canyons are so big and wide, I'm guessing they're not going to do anything to restrict your hours of daylight. But then again, you also don't get any benefits from blocking up more of the GCR, again, because of the regional topography. Is that about right?
That's correct, although the low elevation does block some of the radiation as shown by Curiosity.
One of the things that struck me about all four sites is that it seemed like, at least based on the presentation, there's a little bit of a chicken and the egg here. The CTX oftentimes forms a really good base, which is sort of the intent. And high-rise is doing a good job of sampling the sort of basic terrain types. And like Alfred, you were suggesting what you really need are the stereo data, the DTMs, to look at the stratigraphic relations and that sort of thing, and chrism compositional information. But it sounded like the sort of basics of the information to do the interpretation were there. I think, Angel, you commented about data for the walls, but is that a fair statement, where there's sort of large areas of terra incognita that you couldn't evaluate because you didn't have the data?
Yes, there are large areas of terra incognita. With a 100-kilometer radius, there's lots of good stuff that you can point out, so we pointed out the good stuff.
Right, but I guess what I was asking is, as you identify terrain types, were you able to sample most of those terrain types with high-rise, or were there large bunches that you couldn't?
I'd like a lot more high-rise.
Well, I would too, obviously. It's not, and, you took that question in a direction I wasn't trying to go.
It's hard to say until we get the data. The area isn't as well sampled as we'd like, because there's so much competition in that region of Mars, right, with lots of interesting targets.
Okay, last question.
There was one person who mentioned the valley's depth, and then the availability for solar light. No mention has been made on power supplies for these bases. There's basically two that we normally talk about, solar and radiothermonuclear. But a third one that has been worked on a little bit that has been mentioned is the possibility for a wind-driven energy resource. And in some of these long, diurnal slope areas, that could be a potential additive resource that hasn't been considered.
I think rho could be a problem. The density is low.
But there's actually been studies done on it, some papers published that it's capable.
Anybody know more about it than I do?
Okay, all right, this is the last question. actually, no.
Okay.
Sorry, you're standing right underneath a blinding light. It's very difficult to see. In fact, it might be nice if those could be moved tomorrow, because I feel badly for the speakers. So we're done for today.
Yeah, so just one, if you've been filling out the polling sheets, the questions 1 and 2, please hand them in to the front desk. If you haven't quite finished them yet and really want to do them this evening, then you can hand them in first thing in the morning, but we'd rather get them tonight. And then just a reminder to please get your talks in as early tomorrow as possible, because it just helps speed things up. And finally, I'd just like to thank the last four speakers again.